My distinguished colleagues in Parliament, Sri Suresh Angadi ji, Sri Kore ji, Sri Ram Madhav ji, my colleague in the party, all other dignitaries present here, ladies and gentlemen. First, let me thank you very, very much for giving me an opportunity to come and speak to you in this very beautiful campus with such a stellar and very engaged audience present here. I'm also delighted to be here because this event, in fact, I think is inspired by two of my own personal role models and heroes, Swami Vivekananda ji and Sri Visvesharaya ji. And I'll tell you, ladies and gentlemen, because I'm an engineer myself, for all of us as engineers, you know, Engineers Day is, of course, after our very, very distinguished builder of the nation, Sri Visvesharaya ji. So thank you very much again for giving me an opportunity to come and speak to you on a set of topics that I think will be quite close and of great interest to both Swami Vivekananda ji's thought processes and Sri Visvesharaya ji's thought processes. Now, in some ways, the audience that you all are will appreciate what I'm going to say. I think you might challenge what I'm also going to say, which will be, for me, a very interesting and engaging aspect of this whole exercise. So let me present my thoughts, and in a way what Rajat did and the other distinguished speaker who came before him did was to set up what I'm going to say in a very, very interesting way. Because they talked about a lot of the challenges that India is facing in terms of its economy, and they also highlighted the important role that the political economy and the political system play in taking our country forward as far as the economy is concerned. And I will address those very same issues when I make my presentation. And what I will talk about today, and of course, being a former management consultant, since I'm going to be speaking to you all, I have to use some charts. So you'll permit me to use a few charts to display exactly you know, what I mean by some of my numbers and some of my concepts. But what I want to talk about is to build on what was discussed earlier and begin to talk about what it is that we as an economy, as a country, need to do to move forward. And this is not looking back to the past, ladies and gentlemen. This is really about what we as a country and as an economy need to do for the future. And when you speak to economists, and of course, I'm an engineer, not an economist, I find that the economists, when they talk about development, always talk about one conventional, traditional development model. And that traditional development model, which they say is the only way in which a country can develop, is generally in the popular press referred to as the farm-to-factory, the farm-to-factory development model. And that farm-to-factory development model proceeds on two vectors. It proceeds on two development vectors. The first is industrialization. So what we have to do is we have to move people away from low productivity agriculture and we have to move them into factories. And so that's what we have to do, which is we have to industrialize. The second important development vector is urbanization. So for us to be able to get more productivity, to be able to have our factories work well, to connect them up with the rest of the world, we have to urbanize, and we have to go from a largely rural population to a largely urban population. So that is the farm-to-factory development model, which in fact has been the development model followed by Great Britain when the Industrial Revolution happened, thereafter by Europe, thereafter by America in the late 1800s and the early 1900s. And it is also the development model that has been followed by Korea, Japan, and most notably in the recent past by China. So when you talk to an economist, they will say, if India has to develop, Rajat, if India needs to grow at 10% plus or have very high GDP growth rates, then the only way you can do it is by farm to factory, get people out of agriculture, put them in factories, put them in cities, and that's the only way you can develop. That is the conventional view. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the problem with economists is that they are economists. and unlike us engineers, they always tend to look backwards into history to see what happens. And engineers like me and like Sri Vishveshwaraiah ji always look forward and see what is possible with technology, what is possible with science. And therefore, I speak as a scientist, as an engineer, and I say that we should not be following the farm-to-factory development model. It is not right for India. We need to follow a different model, and that's what I want to talk about, and I want to talk about how and what we need to do as a government, as policymakers, to support that. I suggest that what we need to follow is the farm-to-frontier development model, where we take India to the productivity frontier, the technology frontier. That should be our own different development model that we should uniquely follow. That's what I'm going to speak about today. So let me go into that through these charts. Now, if I can just get the charts to move backwards, I seem to have pressed it too fast. Let me start, first of all, as a politician. When you speak to economists, they'll talk about numbers, they'll talk about theories. But as a politician, as an elected member of parliament from the Lok Sabha, and I'm sure Suresh ji will agree with me, we have to talk about people, not about numbers, not about theories. And my problem, and the problem of India, ladies and gentlemen, is that I have to get Bhola Mehto a job. I have to get Bhola Mehto a job. And that is our development dilemma. Now, Bhola Mehto does not want a job. Bhola Mehto is a voter in Hazaribagh, Jharkhand, where I'm from. Bhola Mehto does not want a job in the informal sector. He doesn't want a job, Suresh ji, as you will, I'm sure, agree with me. He does not want a job to go and work on a construction site. He does not want a job to go and work on a dhaba. Wo na dhabe mein kaam karna chahte hain, na koi construction site mein kaam karna chahte hain. Bhola Mehto ji, agar naukri chahte hain, to wo chahte hain ki IAS mein unko naukri mili, jaise Shri Amitabh Kant ji jo hain yahan. So he wants to be an IAS officer, get a good job. Or if he is from Belgaon, he will want a job in the IT industry in Bangalore or some other nice place where he'll have a beautiful office and he can get an H-1 visa and travel to the US as well. So Bhola Mehto knows enough today that there is a better future, that he can be aspirational, and he should get a job in a good government service like the IAS or get a job in IT services. Those are the kinds of jobs that India's aspirational class, India's young people want today. The problem, ladies and gentlemen, is that these kinds of jobs, the good jobs that people want, steady, secure employment, good benefits, regular wages, those jobs are very few in our economy. If you actually look at our income pyramid, you'll find that there are really only 50 million people in India today that are actually living in families where the family income is more than 1 lakh a month. And that is a good job by global standards. Then there are another 300 million people, and this is roughly our middle class, that has a job that is between 25,000 to 1 lakh, where they have regular employment. So today, if you look at our organized sector, and this is the actual data, if you look at our organized sector is the 37 million plus 18 million. It's about 55 million people that have a job which is an organized formal sector job. But we have a workforce of 464 million. These are 2012 data. So it's probably closer to about 500 million people right now. We have 500 million people, and the vast majority of them today don't have formal sector jobs. They have organized, they have jobs in the unorganized sector, and they are not happy with those jobs. They want good jobs that are in the formal sector where they get regular wages. And the challenge that we face is that not only do we have to make sure that people move out of the informal sector into the formal sector, but we also have a large number of young people. Rajat quoted the 65 percent of the population under the age of 35. We have a lot of young people that are joining our workforce, and soon, in about 15 or 20 years, we'll have the largest young workforce in the world of about 700, 750 million people that are looking for good, high-quality jobs. That is the challenge that we face right now. So most people will have to be moved in some fashion or the other out of the informal sector and into the formal sector. But, and here's a very important point to note, government is not creating many jobs. It'll create some jobs. Today there are 18 million people working in the central, state and local governments. But that number is going to grow very, very slowly, maybe 2-3% a year, no more than that. So the vast majority of people who want a formal sector job are going to have to look for it in the private sector, not in the government sector. And this we know as businessmen and entrepreneurs. It is the private sector that has to give Bhola Mehto a good job. It's going to be very difficult to get Bhola Mehto jobs in the government sector, even if he wants to. That is the reality of what the future looks like. We have to create these private sector jobs. Now, this is where we come to this whole question of farm to factory. Today, if Bhola Mehto or somebody like him gets a job in the textile industry, Bangalore has a lot of companies that are in the textile industry. We had the gentleman before us telling us about Coimbatore and Tirupur and so on, and we talked a lot about the textile jobs that exist there. The challenge with getting people out of agriculture, where their output is about $1,600 per farmer, into these factory-type jobs, whether it's in textiles, shoes, toys, making computers, is that their productivity does not go up very much. So even if I can get Bhola Mehto a job from growing paddy in Jharkhand into a Maruti factory or into a Bajaj factory, his productivity only goes up to about $6,000. That's how much output he is generating if he goes and works in a factory. The challenge is at $6,000 of output, we can't really give them a middle income lifestyle. Middle income is close to more like $10,000 of earnings, $10,000 per year. Now, to do that, we have to get Bhola Mehto into industries where his output increases dramatically. Now, if you look at IT services, an engineer working in Bangalore is generating output of about $46,000 per capita. Airlines, high productivity industry, we have people generating output of $67,000. And if you look at financial technology, this is where people are able to generate very significant output. So the only way people can have a middle income lifestyle, the only way Bhola Mehto is going to be able to generate a better quality of life, make income of about $10,000 per year, is if he's in a high productivity industry. If we just move him from farm to factory into a textile factory, his quality of life, his earnings is not going to improve by very much. So if we really want people to be able to have a good middle income, prosperous urban lifestyle, we have to move them into the high productivity industries. We should not be necessarily moving them into factories where they will not be earning a lot more and they'll be living in a crowded, congested city and not be very happy with their life. And at the same time, we'll be making our rural population very restive and unhappy because they're being moved into these crowded, congested cities. So I'm not sure that the farm to factory development model will work for India when we actually confront the data. That is my concern. I think we need to move them into the high productivity industries where their output, their capita, per capita output goes up dramatically, and we have to leapfrog. We have to leapfrog rather than being incremental in our thinking. That is really what is required. If we have to take the Bhola Mehtos, if we have to take our farmers, as I was just driving into Belgaum with Suresh Ji, I saw a lot of farms around Belgaum. So if we have to get these people out of the farms and we have to give them a better quality of life, they need high quality IT services type jobs, not just working in a textile factory. That's what we need to do if we have to sustainably improve lifestyles and genuinely become a middle income country. So how do we do that? Now here's a graph that I think you all will appreciate. We need to be able to increase output. We need to be able to increase productivity. And I think part of the challenge we have in India, in the political discourse, aap kisi se bhi baat kariye, तो अधिकतर जो लोग बात करेंगे, जो भी बातचीत होगी, वो यही होगी कि मुझे नौकरी चाहिए, मुझे रोजगार चाहिए, मैं नौकरी के तलाश में हूँ। सब लोग बस नौकरी और रोजगार के बारे में बात करते हैं। लेकिन जब मैं युवाओं के साथ बातचीत करता हूँ, व्हेन आई स्पीक टू यंग पीपल, इट्स वेरी रेयर फॉर देम टू टॉक अबाउट देयर कैपेबिलिटीज एंड स्किल्स। अगर आपके पास योग्यता नहीं होगी, अगर आपके पास काबिलियत नहीं होगी, तो आपको अच्छी नौकरी मिलेगी कैसे? एंड देयरफॉर वी इन इंडिया हैव टू चेंज द पब्लिक डिस्कोर्स। द पब्लिक डिस्कोर्स हैज टू बी लेस अबाउट गिव मी अ गुड जॉब, गिव मी गुड बेनिफिट्स। इट हैज टू बी मच मोर अबाउट आर वी जेनरेटिंग इन आर पीपल द कैपेबिलिटीज एंड द स्किल्स सो दैट दे कैन अर्न मोर। दैट आई फाइंड एज अ पब्लिक डिस्कोर्स इन द पोलिटिकल इकोनॉमीज वी स्पेंड वेरी लिटिल टाइम ऑन। द फोकस इज लार्जली अबाउट एंटाइटलमेंट एंड लेस अबाउट एम्पावरमेंट। So it's all about entitlement, it's not about empowerment. And the empowerment has to be on two dimensions, ladies and gentlemen. One, we have to equip them with the skills so that they can produce more. And two, we have to embed our people into ecosystems, into value chains, where they can be given the tools so that they can produce more. Both are required. We have to move on both dimensions. When we move people into high quality ecosystems, and when we give them the skills, their output increases. Sounds theoretical? Let me explain it. If you look at somebody in farming, aap agar Jharkhand ke khet mein aaiye aur dhaan ki ropai dekhiye, to dhaan ki ropai jaise hazaron saal pehle hua karta tha, waise aaj ke samay bhi hai. Aap jaiye khet mein, keechad mein jaakar aap dhaan ki ropai kariye, aur jab fasal jo ho jati hai, to fir aap dhaan ki katni aap jaakar usko kaat rahe hain, jaise pehle kiya jata tha waise hi kiya jata hai. Yahan bhi aise hi hoga Suresh ji, hai na? So the people's skills have not improved, the ecosystem, they're not using threshers, they're still abhi haath se dhaan ki katni chal rahi hai, therefore the output is not high. Neither are we giving them the tools, nor do they have the skills, therefore they are not able to produce more. When they go to the factory, in the factory they may have a sewing machine, their skills will improve a little bit, but again their output doesn't increase that much because we are not giving them the tools and the skills they need to increase output. But it's when we actually get them to the technology, the productivity frontier, that's when output really increases. And don't forget that GDP per capita measures what you produce. It measures what you produce. So we have to take our people and we have to make them a lot more productive if we want them to have a better lifestyle. The trick to getting Bhola Mehto a good job is that we have to have Bhola Mehto in a situation where he can produce more. We can't just say, Bhola Mehto, you're entitled to a good job, but not put him in a place where he can produce more. If he can't produce more, he can't get a good job. That is the central puzzle we have to solve. Does that make sense, ladies and gentlemen? You understand what I'm saying? They have to produce more. It's simple. Don't produce, can't earn. Right? Now, how do we do that? It's not that hard. We have to leapfrog our people. So, a Bhola Mehto who can drive a tractor today, if Bhola Mehto can drive a motorcycle and a tractor, why not make Bhola Mehto, let's say, an Ola or an Uber driver? So immediately we take Bhola Mehto, we put him in a car, we give him the technology platform, the navigation system, the billing and payment system, the dispatch system, that enables him to, instead of producing a few thousand rupees per month of output, to produce a few thousand rupees per day of output, because he's now doing ride share. Has his skills improved? No. But instead of being in the farm where he doesn't have any tools and no ecosystem, we've now put him in a car that Ola or Uber are financing for him. We're giving him a billing system, a dispatch system, and a navigation system. Even if he doesn't know the roads of Belgaum, he can drive around because the navigation system is telling him. He doesn't have to go around to the train station or the airport waiting for a ride. He gets dispatched. So his productivity goes up. And his payment is clean. He just has somebody who gets in, they pay automatically, and it gets automatically deposited into his bank account. All the friction of payment goes away. Now, by providing him that technology platform, providing him that business platform, suddenly his productivity has dramatically increased. Instead of producing 4,000-6,000 rupees a month, he's now producing 4,000-6,000 rupees a day of output. The average farmer, ladies and gentlemen, in India has a monthly earning of only 4,000-5,000 rupees a month. His output is very, very low. Here, we can increase his output. And of course, as he becomes an Uber or an Ola driver, acquires the skill, he starts to improve his own skills. And rather than just being a driver, he can now become a delivery person as well. You can go and you can order on Uber Eats, and you can get the best restaurant in Belgaon to make you your food, and the food comes to you because Bhola Mehto has delivered it to your doorstep. So his earnings increase even more because we are giving him more skills, more capabilities. That's how we do it, ladies and gentlemen. We have to take our people, we have to get them to the frontier in terms of technology, and then they automatically start to improve their skills. And that's what we have to do. We have to get people into high output industries. Now, how do we do that? How do we get people into these high output, high productivity industries? We have to build the necessary market infrastructure. We have to build the physical infrastructure, the airports, the highways, all of that. We have to be able to create the market. We have to generate the public platforms that can solve some of these payment, billing, these types of problems. So the government has a very important role to play in being able to create some of these markets. Let me give you a very interesting example of what we are doing with drones right now. And that will again explain this and make this come to life. One of the things we've done uniquely in India, this is a tremendously exciting thing we've done in the last 4 years in our government. We are building a series of public platforms that enable companies like Ola and Uber and other companies to get started. And Aadhaar is a very good example of that. On the basis of Aadhaar, we have built, obviously, UPI and Bheem, which hopefully you're using right now for payments. We have built the GSTN network that allows you to file your GSTN returns. We have built for Ayushman Bharat, ladies and gentlemen, a completely seamless cashless system that enables a Bhola Mehto to come to the best hospital in Belgaon and to get treated and just be paid directly through the network that we have created. This is a fantastic platform that's gotten built as far as healthcare is concerned. And similarly, for example, for drones, we are building a digital sky platform that will enable people to be able to use drones for all kinds of applications. For example, assessing crop damage and paying insurance on it, or for instance, for transporting organs from hospital to hospital. So we are building a combination of public and private platforms in India that is without equal anywhere else in the world, ladies and gentlemen. In America, these platforms are typically owned by the private sector, Google, Facebook, Apple. They are the ones that own these public, these platforms. In China, largely state-controlled, or companies that are largely state-controlled. In India, we have a very innovative combination of things the government is doing and things that the private sector is doing. And that, I think, is the basis for taking a Bhola Mehto and giving him opportunities that, you know, will really enable him to produce more. And so we are now starting to see a host of companies, ladies and gentlemen, that are taking advantage of these public-private platforms to really build these high-output industries. Ola and Uber are examples, but in even companies like Indigo are very high-productivity industries and so on. That's the future for India. It's not necessarily to get people into factories where they can make toys and shoes and clothes. There will be a role for that as well. But we really need to get people more into mass services rather than mass manufacturing. And then the question becomes, can we get the Bhola Mehtos of India enough jobs? Are there enough jobs? Again, let's go back to the data on the formal sector. As I said, there are about 75 million people in the formal sector, of which government jobs, actually this is a typo, is about 18 million. Jobs are about 50 million or so are other jobs. And the number of jobs in these high productivity industries is about 10 million right now. But we know that for every job in a frontier industry, a high productivity industry, there are indirect jobs that are at a ratio of 3:1. So today, frontier industries support about 40 million jobs, some in the informal sector, some in the formal sector, but high productivity industries support about 40 million jobs right now. The challenge for us from a public policy point of view is to be able to grow these jobs at the rate of 2 million a year. So if we can go from 10 million jobs in these high productivity industries, in IT services, in aviation, in financial services, in ride sharing, in renewable energy, in these areas, and if we can go from 10 million to 50 million frontier jobs, we will also create a host of indirect jobs And therefore, the total number of jobs we will create this way will be 50 million direct jobs, and then 150 million indirect jobs, and a total of jobs of 200 million, which are linked to high productivity industries. Now, this is not at all inconceivable. I'll give you the example, ladies and gentlemen, of Delhi Airport. And we are seeing the same thing happening with Bangalore Airport right now. Today, Delhi Airport is the largest single employer in NCR outside of government. Largest single employer. You know how many people work in Delhi Airport? About 6 lakh people work in Delhi Airport right now, of which about 1.5 lakh are directly employed in Delhi Airport, and then another 4.5 lakhs are indirectly employed in Delhi Airport. And Delhi Airport alone today has about an investment of 30 to 35,000 crores. It's the single largest infrastructure project in India. We have another 15,000 crores of investment lined up. Delhi Airport will have total investments of 50,000 crores and employ lakhs and lakhs of people. And as I said, people working in airports, people working in aviation are working in a very high productivity industry, and their jobs and the kind of money that they make is much, much higher than if they were working just in a factory. You know how much a captain makes? A captain flying a plane today, an Airbus 320 or a Boeing 737, is making more than a crore a year. So those are the kinds of jobs that we create if indeed we are able to grow these high productivity indices. And that's why the more of these jobs we create, the more prosperity, the more employment that we can provide. And of course, government has a big role to play in this. We really have to ensure, as I said, that the private sector flourishes, that we really enable markets to take off, because that's really where these jobs are going to come from private sector companies. And what we need to do is to ensure that we jumpstart these industries of the future. Typically, these industries go through an S-curve. The role of government is really boosting this S-curve, really ensuring that these industries take off. And then, ladies and gentlemen, if indeed we can jumpstart these industries, create these high productivity industries, we will create a future for Bhola Mehto. We will create a future for Bhola Mehto. Bhola Mehto, in my own city, my own hometown of Hazaribagh, can become a dairy farmer so that he has multiple cows, and then he can supply his milk to a dairy processing plant. He could also go work in a dairy processing plant where he can make cheese and ice cream and yogurt and all of these processed foods for you. I was just at the airport. I was very pleased to see Sureshji and I were talking. You have a company here, Aditya, right, Sureshji? You have a company, Aditya, and hopefully Aditya has got a number of farmers who have cows, who are producing milk, and are then able to sell to Aditya, who is then selling ice cream and yogurt and lassi and all of these products. So right here in Belgaum, this is happening. This is happening. We are getting our farmers plugged into high output industries so that they can generate a better life for themselves. But it is not, ladies and gentlemen, only about Bhola Mehto. It's not just about Bhola Mehto. It is about Geeta Oraon too. We need to create good jobs for Geeta Oraon too. But Geeta Oraon should not have to leave Jharkhand and come to Bangalore and work in a textile factory. There are already business models that are being created by companies like Lime Road, where Geeta Oraon can work in the village itself with a sewing robot. She can go, of course, work in a textile factory, but she can also work with a sewing robot in a village where you choose the fabric, you choose the design. With a sewing robot, she can make you that shirt, that kurta, whatever dress you want, really, really fast, ship it back to you with reverse logistics, and generate much, much more output than if she was just living in a mud hut in Hazaribagh. So we can, if we take these people, take them from farm to frontier, whether it's Bhola Mehto or Geeta Oraon, the people I represent, we can create these futures for them. We can create a much more prosperous life for them. But we cannot be trapped by the models of the past. We cannot become an industrialized country like China, moving everybody into cities, becoming 80-90% urbanized. We have to protect our way of life. We have to protect our values. We have to protect our culture, and we can do that if we have much more balanced development. We give people the skills and the tools so they can produce where they are and lead a much better life than to just crowd into a few cities. Thank you very much. Happy to take any questions.
So, Jayant sir, before I would ask you some political questions, I would like to ask you some questions in your capacity as the Minister of State for Civil Aviation. In the morning, you were having in Belgium with respect to the aviation. And as a minister, what is your vision for the tier 2 cities of India in general with respect to the airlines industry?
No, thank you very much for asking that question, because I know that better flight connectivity is a very important issue for Belgaum. And we are all very pleased, of course, that Belgaum is now very much a part of the third round of Udaan. And I want to thank Shri Kore Sahab and Shri Suresh Angadi Sahab, relentlessly pursuing it and really serving the interests of the people of Belgaum by making sure not just we in government ensured that Belgaum would be part of Udaan 3, which of course it would have been, but also by going to IndiGo and SpiceJet and Air India and all the other airlines and really explaining to them what an attractive airline market Belgaum actually is. And I'm very pleased when I came here today and I saw the wonderful development that is happening here, the range of educational institutions, the manufacturing factories that are here, the agricultural and horticultural produce that is happening here. It is very clear to me that Belgaum deserves many, many, many more flights. And we also spoke to Srimati Usha Padhi ji, who's the joint secretary, who's handling Udaan. And she already is starting to get indications of interest from airlines as to how they're going to bid in Udaan 3. And what she told us about the interest level that people have in Belgaum right now, ladies and gentlemen, was very encouraging, very promising. So I'm quite hopeful. I'm quite hopeful and almost certain, in fact, that all the flights that were here will largely get restored, and Belgaum will not only get all the flights that it had, but because of the inherent potential here and the rate and speed at which airline traffic is growing, you will have very, very good connectivity from Belgaum, which is what Belgaum deserves and Belgaum requires. So I'm very hopeful that that is going to happen. And the story of Belgaum, coming back to your question, the story of Belgaum is the story of Bikaner. It's the story of Jaisalmer. It's the story of Kanpur. It is the story of Jamshedpur in my own Jharkhand. It is the story of Tejpur. It is the story of Pakyong. There are 34 such airports, ladies and gentlemen, that have been started through Udaan. And Udaan has been a massive success, because if you think about the speed and the rate at which airports were being opened prior to Udaan, you'll realize that there were 1 to 2 airports a year that were getting started. 1 to 2 airports a year, that's it. And, you know, in fact, it was, you know, the right commercial decision for airlines to say, I'll add one more flight between Delhi and Bangalore rather than add a flight to Hubli or Belgaum. It was the right commercial decision for them. And what we did in government with Udaan was to create the economic incentives and unleash the market forces, so that rather than adding one more flight from Delhi to Bangalore, they started adding flights to Hubli and Belgaum and Bikaner and Kanpur and everywhere else, so that we got much more balanced regional development. And that's why Udaan has been so successful. And of course, as I said, one clear indicator of Udaan's success is the fact that in the 2 rounds of bidding, we've opened 34 airports, and there are many more airports to come. We're going to open 51 helicopter heliports. 51 helicopter heliports, which, by the way, for hilly states like Uttarakhand and Himachal Pradesh and Jammu and Kashmir and Manipur and so on, are going to be a lifeline, because for them, because of all of the difficulties in traveling even short distances through hilly terrain with landslides and so on, makes them very, very cut off. And so we're going to address that through these heliports for which we are providing subsidies. And now in Udaan 3, we are opening up international markets. So a city like Guwahati, as Rajat was saying earlier, is going to get several international destinations as well. So we've opened up all these different airports, 34 airports for scheduled commercial service, heliports, and this is where you really begin to see the difference it's made. SpiceJet has ordered 50 turboprops, Q400s, 50 turboprops. IndiGo has ordered 50 ATRs just so that they can cater to the regional market. And this is a clear example of how we've unleashed market forces, created the economic incentives so that airlines are really starting to build out not just their connections between the major cities, but also these regional routes so that they can really provide connectivity to all of you in tier two, tier three, and tier four towns. That, to my mind, is one of the great successes of our government in this term. And I think will at some level go down along with the telecom revolution as part of the great connectivity revolution that is happening in India.
A question related to this that I wanted to ask was that Air India recently went through debt restructuring. Where do you think we went wrong with Air India privatization? And another question which I would want to club with this is, why are we reluctant to open up our aviation industry to 100% FDI? Because a Delhi to Aizawl flight sometimes costs as high as 80,000 rupees. And in that amount, we could do a to and fro from Delhi to London. So
you asked three questions. The first question about Air India privatization, the second question about 100% FDI, and the third question about dynamic pricing in the airline industry. I'll address all three of those. First, with respect to the Air India strategic disinvestment, we offered 76% of Air India for sale to any bidder. And we think it was a very fair and balanced offer that took into account the interests of the people who have invested thousands and thousands of crores in Air India and potentially what the private sector would want in terms of bidding for Air India. We think it was a very fair and balanced offer, and this is the first time Air India had in fact been put up for privatization. No other government had the courage to do it. Our government did it. But unfortunately, our timing was wrong. You said, well, what prevented it from being sold? The answer is timing. Because just as we brought it to the market for sale, industry conditions deteriorated dramatically and massively. Oil prices went up from about $50 a barrel to $80, $85 a barrel. Interest rates shot up, the rupee weakened, and all of the airline industry hit the down part of the cycle. The financial condition deteriorated. And under those circumstances, for the airlines to go in and bid for Air India, which would have been quite a major undertaking, was not the right decision for them from a timing point of view. So obviously, as a result of that, we didn't get any bidders. And therefore, we as government decided that we would continue to strengthen and make Air India more competitive, make it a vibrant global carrier, but at the same time, wait for better industry conditions, and then once again, reevaluate the disinvestment process. So let's wait and see how quickly industry conditions change, and already you can see oil prices are coming down. So we are once again moving out of the down part of the cycle to the better part of the cycle, and we are very hopeful that as time goes on and Air India gets stronger and better, that there will be a lot of people who will be very interested in Air India when things turn around. So that's your first question. With respect to the Air India privatization, as I said, we made a very fair and balanced offer. When industry conditions are right, I'm sure people will step forward and participate in the privatization process. Second, your question was, why don't we have 100% FDI as far as our airline industry is concerned? We have one of the most, if not the most, liberal FDI regime in the aviation sector in India today. 100% of an airport can be owned by a foreign investor. 100% of ground handling, 100% of MRO. In all these different areas, we allow 100% FDI. When it comes to the airline industry, we allow up to 49%. 49% for foreign carriers. Now, the reason we don't do more than that is because when you look at bilateral rights, which is the rights that airlines have to fly to another country. So if you flew from here to Kuala Lumpur, from Belgaum to Kuala Lumpur, or if you flew from Belgaum to Singapore, the only company that could do that would be a company that was genuinely a domestic carrier that had significant ownership and effective control of Indian domestic players. Because otherwise, Singapore would not allow it. And that is the way the whole bilateral regime globally is set up. And around the world, if you look as to what the FDI regime is, you'll find virtually in every country, including the United States, there is a cap of 49%. So what we're doing with 49% cap for international carriers in India is absolutely in line with both the bilateral frameworks that we have as well as what the global standards are. So we are very, very open. We are as open as any other country in the world. We've received significant investment. You know, Singapore Airlines is a 49% owner of Vistara. You know that AirAsia, 49% owner of AirAsia. You know that today Etihad is a 26% owner of Jet Airways. So we are very liberal in that respect. And therefore, we have opened up our airline industry dramatically. So our regime is as open as any other regime in the world. Now let me come to your third question about dynamic pricing. This is a question that comes up with all audiences that I participate in these kinds of Q&As. Why is pricing so variable? Why is it that sometimes I can get a ticket for 3,000 rupees and other times a ticket for 15,000 rupees? By the way, the 80,000 is not true. This is one of those urban myths where people will come up with three connections for something and say, hey, look, I did it on Clear Trip or Make My Trip and it's coming out to 80,000. Here's a screenshot. Look at 80,000. Not true. Not true. You'll never get an 80,000 non-stop or one stop. If you do three stops and you juggle it around to sensationalize, you can do it. But it's not practical and it doesn't really happen. But yes, there is significant fluctuation in airline pricing. And it is to the benefit of consumers. Let me explain. Suppose you book a flight a month in advance and you really want the lowest price possible. When you book it a month in advance and you take a middle seat and you don't want to buy any food, you don't want anything else, you will get genuinely a rock bottom price. You will get a price for 2,000, 3,000 rupees. Now, if you want additional benefits, airline service has been unbundled. If you want a flight one day before you want to travel, then you pay more for that. If you want to drink juice on the plane, then you can pay more for that. If you want to sit in the front of the airplane, then you pay more for that. If you want to take more luggage, then you pay more for that. If you want an aisle seat, then you pay more for that. And that is fine because the person who wants to pay more can pay more. The person who wants to buy a ticket 1 month ahead of time and sit in a middle seat and not eat anything and bring fruit for home, they can also get a ticket. So by enabling this kind of unbundling, we are actually giving consumers more choices and enabling fares to be very, very low for the people who can make those decisions. And ladies and gentlemen, let me also tell you, there's been a lot of research. Indian airfares are among the lowest, if not the lowest in the world. So please understand, it's not as if airlines are charging you an arm and a leg. In fact, they're charging you very, very low airfares. You're getting a great deal and you're getting it all unbundled so you can buy what you want. If you go, now just to conclude with this, agar aap jaake dhabe mein chai peete hain, 10-15 rupaye ke aap dhabe mein aapne chai peejiye, theek hai, badhiya chai mil gayi aapko. Aap wahi chai jaake 5-star hotel mein lijiyega to aapko 100 rupaye dene padenge. Aap Starbucks mein jaake wo chai peejiyega tab aapko 150-200 rupaye dene padenge. To aap kehte hain kyon, humko yahan 10 rupaye dene hain aur wahan 100 rupaye dene, band kar do, regulate kar do. Aise ho sakta hai? So, nahi ho sakta hai. Because it's, pricing has to be left to the market. Give consumers choices. Agar aap paison pe hi aapko nirnay lena hai, to theek hai, aap train le lijiye. It depends on what you're optimizing. Are you optimizing time? Are you optimizing convenience? Are you optimizing price? We have to give you the full range of choices. In a market economy, we have to provide those choices. Let people decide what they want and let them take it. Now, obviously, if there is something that is anti-competitive, if there are things that people are doing without giving consumers full information, then really as a market regulator, we will look at that. But you are free to make your choices. You don't want to buy the juice, don't buy the juice.
Jayant sir, there has been a clear intent of this government to fundamentally shift the way in which policy has been conceptualized in this country. The presentation that you made, for instance, is talking about driving real change in real people's lives. But how do you deal with an impatient electorate where there is a fair amount of intellectual inequality in this country as well, where they might not be able to understand your clarity of vision coming from where you come from? So how do you deal with it as an MP?
You deal with it by making sure Bhola Mehto gets a good job. So, no, you, of course, policy making has to operate at multiple levels. We have people who are, you know, living a life where they need ration. They need chawal, ek rupay ki chawal ki zarurat hai, to hum unhe ration card dilwate hain. They are people who are spending 3 to 4 hours going into forests, collecting lakkad, jisme ki wo chulha jalaye. Kuch log hain jo ghanto goitha banate hain. Goitha aapko maloom hai kya hai? Goitha hai ki aap cow dung lekar, aap uska goitha banakar, aap fir chulha chalate hain. Log aise bhi hain. अच्छा उन लोगों के लिए हम लोगों ने गैस सिलेंडर दिलवा दिया. झारखंड में हमने सिर्फ सिलेंडर नहीं, हमने चूल्हा भी दिलवा दिया. तो वहाँ हम लोगों ने उनको बहुत सुविधा दी है. गली नली का काम है वो भी हम लोग कर रहे हैं, क्योंकि हम लोगों ने हर मुखिया को 14वें वित्त आयोग के कारण हम लोगों ने हर मुखिया को, जहाँ पहले आपको 2 लाख रुपये मिलते थे, हमने हर मुखिया को 25 से 30 लाख रुपये दे दिए. अब जो जो आपको गाँव में काम करवाने हों, चाहे वो चापानल हो, चाहे वो तालाब गहरीकरण हो, चाहे वो पीसीसी सड़क हो, चाहे वो सामुदायिक भवन हो, ऐसे ऐसे जो छोटी छोटी योजनाएं हैं जो आपको गांव में देहात में आपको जो काम करना है, उसके लिए हम लोगों ने मुखिया को सक्षम बना दिया. अब मुखिया वो काम कर रहे हैं. तो चाहे वो गली नली का काम हो, गैस सिलेंडर का काम हो, चाहे वो किसी के लिए शौचालय बनाना का काम हो, वो काम हम लोग कर रहे हैं, वो हो रहा है. और आप अगर जाकर अभी जाकर जनता से पूछेगा तो वो आपको अवश्य बताएंगे कि विकास धरातल पे हमने उतार के दिखाया है. शौचालय बने हैं, गैस सिलेंडर का वितरण हुआ है, सड़कें बनी हैं. तो ये काम तो हम लोग कर ही रहे हैं. लेकिन जैसे एज आई टोल्ड यू, वी हैव टू वर्क ऑन मल्टीपल लेवल्स. सो इवन एज वी आर डूइंग दैट, गाँव देहात में हम लोग ये कर रहे हैं, एट द सेम टाइम वी आर ऑल्सो कमिंग अप विद ड्रोन पॉलिसी. We are also ensuring that we have a robust drone ecosystem where we are at the cutting edge of regulation globally, so that, and particularly with Karnataka, with a very robust aerospace high-tech industry, we can give you through regulations an opportunity to leapfrog the rest of the world and really become a hub for building and powering drones right here. So everything is required. We need to do what is required for people living in villages. We need to do what's required for people at the technology frontier as well. And our policy making has to span all of that. And in fact, it does. And that's why we are showing development on all these dimensions, development in all these different ways.
I'll come to the Bijli Sadak Pani, that the BSP factor in a bit. But this question of jobs, there have been a lot of questions which have come from the audience also on that count. Do you think is it an urban myth created by the opposition that there are no jobs in India being created? Do you think job creation is an issue? And if it is, how does your government foresee a future towards job creation?
We are doing a superb job on job creation. So if you look at what we have done over the last 4.5 years, and you look at the number of jobs that are being created, the quality of jobs that are being created, we are probably doing better than any other government has done before. And, you know, we can go through all the statistics. You can look at the EPFO data. You can look at the data in terms of, you know, new industries like renewable energy, aviation, e-commerce. In all of these different areas, lots of jobs are being created. You know, you look at salaries just today. Yesterday, I saw in the paper that in the IITs, I myself am from IIT Delhi, that people are getting jobs, you know, people who've just got a BTech degree that are 25 lakh rupees today. Now, that would not be happening in the labor market if indeed there wasn't tremendous demand for those kinds of people. So clearly, we have well-functioning, flourishing labor markets. People are being employed. People are getting good jobs. Now, that is where we are today. However, the challenge, of course, is what I presented, which is that today itself, we have about 500 million people. And of those 500 million people, only about 75 million people are in formal sector jobs. The rest of them, 425 million people, are in informal jobs. So we have to be able to get people from the informal sector into the formal sector so that they get better, higher quality jobs, producing more, and at the same time absorb the vast number of young people that will be coming into the workforce over the next 15 or 20 years. So that formalization has to happen, which is why demonetization was so important. Formalization has to happen on the one hand, and we have to have continued strong job creation going forward. Relative to those two challenges, is the economy doing enough? No. And that's why we have to work even harder. And that is why I'm pushing farm to frontier, because I don't want people trapped in dead-end, low-quality jobs. when this all happens, I want people to get high quality jobs, jobs that will enable them to survive and flourish in the future, because the world is moving very fast and we have to leapfrog. So that is the challenge in front of us. Not what we've done. Of course, we've done a super job, but we, for India's sake, have to do a lot more and we have to keep at it.
So few political analysts believe that BJP does a fantastic job with the Bijli Sadak Pani, the BSP factor in India. We build absolutely brilliant roads. We have almost 100%, electricity has reached almost 100% of villages in India today. But do you think there is a certain perceptible gap in moving the boundaries, in pushing the boundaries beyond infrastructure? For example, do we have an education policy in place? Do we have a robust economic policy in place? Do we have a robust healthcare policy in place?
Well, thank you very much for saying that we are doing a fantastic job. And you're exactly right. We are doing a fantastic job. Whether you look at what we're doing in highways, where Nitinji has done just absolutely brilliant work and the rate of highway construction is up 3 times. Whether you look at what has happened in railways, Piyush ji just put out some statistics on accidents, and I don't want to jinx anything, but you can see how well we are doing now on all of that. The build out of the railway network, the safety of the railway network. I've already given you all the data as far as the aviation sector is concerned. In aviation, just remember, in 4.5 years, we've doubled traffic, which is extraordinary. No other country in the world is growing in terms of airline traffic as fast as we are growing. And also, let me just very quickly on airlines and aviation explain one thing, which is that today, the airline industry is already generating revenues of 1.8 lakh crores. 1.8 lakh crores. That is the size of India's telecom sector. The revenues of all of our telecom companies are also about 1.8 lakh crores. And the total revenues of Indian railways is also 1.8 lakh crores. So you can see that the airline industry in India is already a very large industry. It's the same size as telecom and the same size as railways. But given how fast we are growing and the fact that, you know, in a city like Belgaum, we could add 20, 30 flights and absorb all of that, you know that we have tremendous growth still coming as far as airlines are concerned. So in infrastructure, there's tremendous growth. We are building out capacity. We are going to quadruple. We are going to, you know, really add all of that capacity in all of the infrastructure sectors. And we are doing extremely well in terms of both build out, safety, as well as regulation. So infrastructure has been a great success story for us. But take other sectors as well, to your point. Take healthcare. Ayushman Bharat is a revolutionary, revolutionary policy. To be able to say to people, a BPL card holder, that you can go to any hospital anywhere in India and be able to get 5 lakhs rupees worth of treatment is an incredible protection for them. Incredible protection. And I'm very proud to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, I'm very proud to tell you that in Jharkhand, we have extended it from the BPL card holders to everybody who has a ration card in Jharkhand, which is 80% of the population, 57 out of 68 lakh families. We have got 83% of Jharkhand's population covered by Ayushman Bharat. So our healthcare policy, the build out of medical colleges, hospitals, all of that in healthcare has been extraordinary. You want to talk about education. Do you know what we've done with the IIMs? We have given the IIMs autonomy in a way that they could never even have conceived. We've made them completely independent institutions. We've got the institutions of eminence. My own IIT, IIT Delhi, has become an institution of eminence, and we are putting it on the path of global eminence as well. And we have dramatically unshackled many of our universities and colleges through the changes we made in UGC. Of course, we are pushing forward on primary and secondary education also on many, many dimensions. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that. But every sector you look at, and this is part of the challenge that we have, is that it's difficult to communicate in a crisp, succinct manner the fact that virtually every sector has been transformed. Every sector. I just gave you education, I gave you healthcare, I could talk about what we've done in banking, what we've done in asset management, I can talk to you about what we've done in agriculture, and I could go on and on, but you'd be bored to death, so I'm going to shut up here.
Jayant sir, the question, I'll try to explain the question more. This question stems from from a belief in certain section of the media and certain section of the intelligentsia, which sort of puts this tag of anti-intellectualism on your party. It believes that for all the good work we do, there is no thought, a well-detailed thought process behind the policy initiatives that we take beyond infrastructure. There's no question raised on the amount of rail networks or the road network or the air connectivity, etc. The question is pretty much to do with policy. Let me be more specific and more clear. For example, Congress had a rights-based approach to policy making. If one were to ask you a question, what is BJP's basic broader vision when it comes to policy making?
Well, first of all, I'm not an intellectual, so I don't feel like I'm qualified to answer this question. I'm sure anything I say will be quickly derided by those who are genuine intellectuals, write books and, you know, write op-eds and those kinds of things. My job is to make gullies, gully nali, aur bola main to ji ko naukri lagwa de to mere liye bahut badi baat ho jayegi. To main to wo karta rehta hu, isliye I don't feel fully qualified to answer this. But I will say to you that we have a very clear idea of what we want to do. And the very clear idea of what we want to do is we want India to be a strong and prosperous country. Hamari rashtravadi soch hai. Aur hum sab chahe sansthaen hain ya hamari sab jo companies hain, hamari sab jo educational institutions hain, in sab ko hum aur durust banana chahte hain. So our goal is very clear. We want India to develop in all dimensions and be a strong and prosperous country. Now for that, obviously as a government, you have to work on multiple dimensions. You have to work on infrastructure, you have to work on developing human capital through health and education. We have to have a policy that really promotes our entrepreneurs, which we are doing through Startup India. We have to ensure that, you know, our farmers prosper, so we are doing that. So as I was saying earlier, if you look at every sector, if you look at every dimension, you'll find everything that we're doing is really designed so that India is a strong and prosperous country that is poised for the future. And that is our ideology, that is what we are working towards. And I don't know how to describe it in some very catchy intellectual way, because again, as I said, I'm not an intellectual.
You work with some of the finest minds globally in McKinsey and other corporate portfolios that you've had. When this government came to power, there was this there was a huge conversation around the overhaul of the bureaucracy. Why do you think we've not been able to turn around the bureaucracy as was conceptualized earlier?
We've taken very many steps to actually strengthen governance in India. If you look at the bureaucracy itself, we've instituted a number of things to strengthen and improve the quality of our bureaucracy, including 360 degree reviews. Include in that, of course, is a very much of a merit-based approach to promoting and advancing bureaucrats. We have really focused on accountability for our ministries and our bureaucrats so that we can deliver the results. And that is precisely why we are, in fact, delivering results in sector after sector. And we have also been very committed to the development and building up the skills of our public servants and our civil servants. And, you know, the Honorable Prime Minister himself spends a lot of time with civil servants, working with them on, you know, what our goals are, what our mission is, and really trying to inspire them to do their best. And I think you'll find that, you know, most people in the bureaucracy will tell you that they have felt more energized and more inspired by this government than they've ever felt with any other government. And that's why we are able to, in a short 4.5 years, deliver the results that we have.
Yes. So, can we have some questions from the audience, please?
I'm Subhash Kulkarni from Press Trust of India. My question is, As just now she asked a question about controlling of the bureaucracy, the fact remains that the government gives statistics which are many times not correct. The benefits what you have been programmed and the schemes what you designed doesn't reach the last man in the remote village, and this is a fact. Similarly, and this is your father, Ms. Jaya Sinha, your father also has been very critical about the functioning of this government.
Sir, can you keep the question short and crisp?
Yeah. So, how do you explain on this?
Well, I think I would have to disagree with you. I come from Jharkhand, which is a very poor state, and I travel into very remote areas constantly. और अगर आप मुझे Twitter वगैरह में follow करें, social media में follow करें, तो आजकल हाल में what I've been doing recently, कि मैं लाभुकों को जाकर उनकी बातें मैं टेप करके सोशल मीडिया में मैं चला रहा हूँ, जिसमें कि लोगों को भी हकीकत पता चले. पीपल नीड टू नो द ग्राउंड रियलिटी. कल ही मेरे ट्विटर टाइमलाइन में एक वायरल हो गया वीडियो. हम लोग गए हुए थे पीढ़ी पंचायत में, बदानी नगर रामगढ़ जिले में, और वहाँ एक महिला थी जो आदिवासी महिला है, और उन्होंने मेरे ट्विटर फीड पर, वो है, आप देख सकते हैं मेरा वायरल फीड, वो कहने लगी कि भाई देखिए हम लोगों को कितना कुछ मिला है. प्रधानमंत्री आवास योजना मिली है हमें, शौचालय मिला है हमें, चूल्हा और गैस सिलेंडर मिला है. ये विकास धरातल पे उतर के आ रहा है रिमोट एरियाज में. झारखंड में देखिए, मैं कर्नाटक के बारे में नहीं कह सकता हूँ क्योंकि मैं कर्नाटक के गाँव में दौरे नहीं करता हूँ, लेकिन झारखंड मैंने तो बहुत दौरे किए हुए हैं. दूर देहात में जाकर, दूर दराज गाँव में जाके मैंने चौपाल के चौपाल, मैंने ऐसे 100 चौपाल किए हुए हैं और लोगों से मैंने बातचीत की हुई है. और मैं आपको पूरे विश्वास से कह सकता हूँ, और जैसे मैंने कहा सोशल मीडिया में, ट्विटर में आप देखते चले जाइए, मैं पूरे विश्वास से आपको कह सकता हूँ कि लोगों को जो लाभ जो हम लोग दे रहे हैं वो मिल रहे हैं. और आप जो उसको आंकड़े कह रहे हैं, फैक्ट्स कह रहे हैं, मेरे फैक्ट्स तो अलग हैं, मेरे फैक्ट्स अलग हैं. अब चलिए ठीक है, आपके कुछ फैक्ट्स होंगे, बट फैक्ट्स कैन नॉट बी इन डिस्प्यूट. फैक्ट्स आर फैक्ट्स, ओपिनियंस कैन बी डिफरेंट, बट फैक्ट्स आर फैक्ट्स. सो As far as my facts are concerned, I can see the development on the ground. I talk to real people all the time. I spend a lot of time in the field, and that's what I am seeing. So I'll have to disagree with you on that point. Now, let's come to the second question that you asked. And again, you know, the fact is the bank accounts have been opened, the gas cylinders have been distributed, the toilets have been built. If you please come with me to Jharkhand, I will show you village after village after village, the toilets built, ladies using the toilets, the gas cylinders there. This is a matter of actual reality. So that is, I think, not to be disputed. Just yesterday, and I'll just conclude with this point on this particular topic. Just yesterday, you know, I was with 5 ladies who have benefited from Ayushman Bharat. 2 of them had complicated deliveries. And if they had not been able to go to a good private hospital and get good cesarean deliveries, they might have died, the children might have died. They all were saved because instead of going to a, you know, not a good clinic and so on, they went to the best clinic where their everything was covered by Ayushman Bharat. And you should have seen what they said. I have taped it, it's on social media. People are thanking us for this. This is happening with Ayushman Bharat right now. I don't know what facts you're talking about. This is happening right now in front of my own eyes. So I have to trust what I see. You're welcome to trust what you see. Now, when it comes to different views that people have, including my father, this is the beauty of our democracy. I think it's wonderful. What's wrong with having disagreements without being disagreeable? Let's all disagree. Let's all dispute. Please go out and test my facts, test what I'm saying, subject it to reality, subject it to analysis. That is what will make our democracy stronger and better. And, you know, obviously, people will have their own views. And when they have their own views and we engage in discourse and we engage in polite discussion in these matters, obviously, we strengthen our democracy and our democratic institutions. This criticism, this kind of debate is most welcome. Because what am I committed to? I'm committed to India's development, and I believe that that can only happen if we strengthen our democracy and our democratic institutions. So I welcome debate and discussion and criticism. Please bring it on. I'm happy because I'm accountable. I'm accountable to the people of India. I'm accountable to the people of my constituency. And I will face the test. Our elections are coming. If people feel I've delivered, they'll vote for me. My father is also a voter. He will also decide, am I deserving of his vote or not? If I'm not deserving of your vote, if you're not happy with my work, turn me out. Throw me out of office. I know in good conscience, I have worked tirelessly, relentlessly. I have worked hard day and night to serve you, sir. And if you're not happy with that, I did my best. That's all I can say.
We can have just one final question from the audience, and I would use this opportunity to give voice to a younger audience.
This is with regard to production. Hello.
So let's please allow one younger voice. People have been raising voices. Yes, yes, the gentleman at the back. Okay. So we'll club a couple of.
If you see the Western market, it is more flooded with either items from Sri Lanka and Bangladesh. You see very little Indian products, especially textile or food industry. Now, is this basically because of our cost of production is high, or is there anything else? And has the government any plans on reviving this situation?
Yeah, that's a complicated question, because you're coming to a global competitiveness. That's a topic that fills libraries as to, you know, in which industries are we globally competitive and for what reasons. But please understand that we as government are committed to strengthening our global competitiveness. We have an export promotion policy. We are working with each industry to strengthen their global competitiveness.
Yes, there was an... yes, please.
As you said, farmers and to be taken to frontier, who is going to be farming?
He wants to ask that when you say that farmers will be taken to frontiers, and where will the farmers go? The scene of agriculture in this country.
No. Obviously, farmers will, many of them will stay on, in the farms that they have. But instead of just doing farming, bas dhan ki ropai nahi karenge, dhan ki fasal nahi hogi. वो लीची की भी फसल होगी, अनार की भी फसल होगी, वो मुर्गी पालन भी करेंगे, बकरी पालन भी करेंगे, गोट चीज़ भी बनाएंगे, बहुत सारे और चीज़ें भी बना सकते हैं. जैसे मैंने भोला महतो जी का दिखाया कि वो डेयरी फार्मर बन गए हैं, तो ऐसे तो बड़े उपाय उनको मिलेंगे ही मिलेंगे. साथ साथ बहुत सारे और जो हमारे किसान भाई और बहन हैं, वो सेमी अर्बन अर्बन एरियाज में भी जाएंगे जब उनके स्किल्स और ट्रेनिंग उनके लिए उनको काबिल बना देगी. सो वी विल सी अ मच मोर डिफ्यूज्ड, आई होप, development model than a very unidimensional model where everybody is leaving agriculture and going into the cities. Couple more questions. Yes, please. No, I understand your question. Let me answer it very quickly. So our offset policy, as you know, is very clear. That in defense, you obviously have to have a sufficient number of offsets when we manufacture. And to the best of my knowledge, that offset can be applied in aerospace, both on the civilian as well as on the defense side. So we are encouraging as much domestic manufacturing. That's part of Make in India. One or two more questions. Yes, please. Yes. We obviously had to have enough currency in circulation to be able to ensure that the economy continues to move, because currency actually is the lifeblood of the economy. We need to have enough currency to be able to get the economy moving forward. So we had to have enough 500 and 2000 rupee notes so that we had enough cash in circulation to keep economic activity moving along. That's why we introduced the 500 and the 2000 rupee notes. And cash to GDP is not quite at the pre-demonetization levels, but it's come fairly close to that already, showing you that the natural demand for cash does exist. But of course, the whole process of putting cash into the bank accounts has enabled us to, A, and I can go through this in great detail in terms of all the benefits, but it has enabled us to get a stock taking as to who has the cash and who doesn't have the cash. It's helped us formalize the economy. It's enabled us to get a lot more deposits into the bank account. And it has strengthened the financialization of the economy in terms of money coming out of real estate and going into financial assets as opposed to real assets like real estate and gold. The answer is yes. In fact, I was in Delhi Airport when we had our first flight using biofuel, which is a spice jet plane that came from Dehradun to Delhi. We are actively encouraging biofuel. The challenge for us is to be able to produce enough biofuel so that our airlines can use it. It's much more economical and much greener. So anyone here who's producing ethanol and would like to use it for aviation, I'm happy to sit down with you and to see what we can do to encourage you more. I'll take one last question, preferably from a young lady or somebody who's not been well represented so far. Any ladies, any young person who wants to ask a question? Okay, young person. Oh, no, there's a young lady here. Yes, the young lady here. Thank you. See, these are the kinds of questions I get asked all the time in my constituency. So thank you for asking me that question. So the 25 lakhs number that I quoted was, I think, just the absolute top number in the IITs right now. So I don't think it's a representative number. It does not represent a median number. So please don't get too pessimistic because of that. Secondly, with respect to how much money you earn, whether you're a dentist, a doctor, an engineer, an MBA, or whatever, that really is what labor markets decide. So depending on how the market clears, whether there are more pilots, more doctors, more engineers, less of them, and what the demand is, that's how the market clears, that's how salaries get set. And, you know, government has some role to play in terms of setting minimum wages and ensuring that, you know, certain employment conditions like maternity leave and a vacation and things like that. So there are some elements that government does regulate. But by and large, because we are in an open market economy, it's the market economy that decides what you get paid.